Welcome to Caltronics Video Newsletter. A new format is coming for our show. Look for us at prime time starting in March. We'll have more details next week.
Welcome to the world of satellite TV opportunities, the marketing techniques magazine for satellite television that reviews the latest technology and introduces you to people you should know.
Satellite TV opportunities is the marketing techniques magazine for satellite TV dealers. Our single purpose is to help dealers increase their sales and their profits through improved marketing techniques.
Call today for your subscription to success, 1-800-922-2812, Satellite TV Opportunities Magazine.
Today's show will feature highlights from the acclaimed Satellite Showtime programs of 1984, something new in mobile phone equipment, a review of the Trans 10 mesh antenna, and why it's flying high, and much more, including industry news.
We've got Mike Kaufman back, heading up the CSC division of Caltronics. And Mike, we had a really fine response from your two other appearances on the show. We talked about the Ritron capabilities for the telephone and industrial strength. And we also wanted to show the people what is happening with the mobile phone. It seems like movies that I used to see, that it was a Mercedes or a Cadillac at best that had a phone in there, and the kids would say, boy, if we ever had something like that in our car, well, that's beyond our means. Today it's not. Why is that, that they're getting more popular?
Well, the prices seem to be coming down quite a bit, and also I think that a lot of the motor companies are promoting mobile telephones with their new models. I believe Cadillac and Lincoln are offering cellular telephones as options this year. And of course, this has brought the advertising up, the awareness to the public, and of course the awareness then creates more purchases, and that causes the prices to go down, yeah. Joe. So
I see that you brought a Midland model here. Tell us about how this works and just what the capabilities are, will you, Mike?
Okay, I sure will, Joe. This Midland model here works in harmony with the cordless telephone that we did show last time and talk some about, the Ritron industrial strength cordless telephone. In many cases, it's a little more convenient to have a cordless portable phone. In other cases, the range and this sort of thing would promote the mobile telephone.
I see.
And this is a very, very simple, straightforward system. In fact, we're going to demonstrate this to you a little bit later on in the show, how this works. I brought the model along here. We'll get a shot of that a little bit later. And also, this is the dialing microphone that works with this particular unit. This is, I'd like to point out, is only the control head. The radio itself mounts behind the seat and is out of reach. Also, this particular unit now is available, and we don't even have the new model yet, Joe, but we have a beautiful new style telephone handset that will work in harmony with this. Not only will you be able to use it with the Ritron industrial strength cordless phone, but it's also capable of operating with Ma Bell's telephone systems nationwide. And this really makes a beautiful system. It has several different formats of dialing, which makes it capable of your low-cost, long-distance rates, and that works out very well.
It isn't too difficult to show people the advantages, not only the convenience, but the money-making advantages of having a phone in the car or truck.
No, it sure is not, Joe. And big talk, of course, has been on cellular telephones, but I guess we can point out at this time that cellular telephones are only operating in a few of our very, very largest cities in the United States.
It'll be some time before they become universal.
That's correct. In the rural areas, it's going to be many, many years. In fact, we may never see them, even in the area that we're living in right now, we may never see cellular. We still have the old mobile telephone format that's been available to customers since the early 1950s. And I guess it has become a lot more popular with the advertising and the promotion I mentioned from cellular.
Well, let's go and have that demonstration you promised.
Okay, we'll sure go on into that, and we'll give you a demonstration. We've got this particular unit is mounted in one of our trucks out here, and we're going to give you an on-hands demonstration, how it works, a little bit on what it sounds like. I might want to point out, Joe, that during the demonstration that we might find that we have some interference getting into the video or into the camera from the transmitter being quite close to the transmitter antenna, so we just thought we might point that out just in case something like that would happen.
That's possible, I suppose, and most people won't carry a camera with
no,
them.
No, most people are not videotaping while you're out there driving around using your mobile telephone.
Okay, well, let's do it then.
Hello, Qualtronics Mobile.
Hey, Mike. This is Joe Couch.
Yes, Joe. How are you doing today?
Get some input from you on exactly how the... I know how candy it is, but just how does it work for a person that is not... that needs the Raytron phone in the car?
Okay, this is, we're using a mobile unit that we have installed here in this pickup truck, and right now I'm talking to you on it. For the customers that are listening, this was a call that just came in from Joe, and this is the way that normally the system works. And at the time that a call comes in, you need to punch the star button twice to answer any telephone call. And then, of course, when we're ready to terminate the call, we hit the pound button, and then, of course, that terminates the call. And that's how it comes or goes for a incoming call. Now, on an outgoing call, you need to punch the star button to get the dial tone, and I'll give that demonstration there, and I'll give you a call back. How does that sound, Joe? Yes, Fran, this is Mike. We're doing some filming, and could you patch me through to Joe Couch, please?
Hi, there you are, Mike.
Yeah, we're back with you here, Joe, and this kind of gave an idea here how the call was placed. And I think what I'll do is I'll go through it again one time slowly for the camera there and kind of explain exactly how we do this. First of all, it's necessary to select the proper channel on the radio, and at which time we turn on the microphone touch tone pad and punch the star button. We get the dial tone, and then we dial just like we would on a regular telephone. And when we're ready to terminate this particular call, all we'll do is hit the pound button, and that will disconnect our portion of the telephone or our portion, the mobile unit, from the telephone. And that's the basic operation here of the mobile telephone using the Raytron industrial strength cordless phone, but this version here is the mobile version, and it has more power and of course more range than what the small portable unit does. So I will talk to you later then, Joe.
Fine.
Okay, bye-bye. Now, Now, we had just placed the disconnect tone, and I think what I'll do is I'll go through here and I'll dial up a pre-recorded message that we have on one of our local radio stations just to kind of go through the dialing procedure and hopefully right here in front of the camera. To start off with, you need to turn the radio on, which is already on. We have a little touch switch here that turns the touch pad on. We get a little red LED that lights up here on the dial. It's then necessary to hit the star button and then hold it for approximately a second. We release, we get a dial tone. We then can go ahead and we can dial the phone number. In this case, it's 76292.
Good afternoon. You've dialed the WIRCO.
And this is a pre-recorded weather message. Now again, when we are finished with our telephone conversation, we can terminate the call at any time by punching the pound button. And that thus hangs up the telephone from the mobile standpoint. And again, if we want to recall dial tone, we hit the pound button, drop the telephone line, pick the telephone line back up, and we'll get a dial tone again to dial the next number. When we're through, again, terminate the call and turn the touchpad off. And that's a basic demonstration of how the industrial strength cordless telephone operates in the mobile version. And in a future demonstration, we'll demonstrate the portable unit.
Well, Mike, you showed us the demonstration nicely, and I don't think I have too many questions. I think even I could learn that real quickly, how to dial out and how to receive a call.
Yes,
it's very simple.
It is a very, very simple format, and the voice comes very, very well with that particular system, has good audio quality, works 99 and 99/100% of the time as far as being able to get the line. Every once in a while, you might possibly even pick up some problems on a telephone line. Even when we pick up our phone, we don't usually get it to go through 100% of the time.
No, you don't. That's
and we're always capable to human error of dialing wrong numbers, but we feel very, very strong that this is as good a quality, or you really can't mm-hmm. beat it, Joe.
I had a question. When you use this in a phone, in a truck or a car, is there an extra charge through the phone company for this type of dialing?
No. As long as you're using your industrial strength cordless telephone, there's no extra charges for that. In other words, the same as when you use one of the consumer models that you can buy in the hardware store.
Mm-hmm.
Works on the same principle. No extra charges or anything connected with it.
Super good. And the range? I'm sort of doubtful. Is it 8 miles or up to? Or?
Okay, with the portable unit, the handheld unit, we're running about 8 miles with it on average terrain. I can feel very, very comfortable saying that average terrain is giving us 20 miles plus with the mobile version. The outside antenna, the added power, better antenna surfaces really increase the range tremendously.
And no big hills in between. Huh?
No, that's correct.
Great.
And the antennas have a little more gain. It really makes a difference.
Mike, I enjoyed it, and I'm learning something every week from you.
Well, we really enjoy presenting it to our viewers, and we'll be discussing telephones, mobile phones, cellular telephones more in the future, and I'm looking forward to it.
Thank you much, Mike. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Joe.
You betcha.
Hi, I'm Jim Sund. Channel Guide gets with the program.
Hi, I'm Leslie Howard.
Hi, I'm Mary Covens.
Hi, I'm Dina Newberg.
Hello, I'm Pat Hennig.
Hello, my name's Catherine Edgar.
And this is Lloyd Covens with some of the Channel Guide crew here at the 1984 SAT Expo. Channel Guide gets with the program every week, 52 times a year. And our new publication, Galaxy One, gives you the best from the new used communication satellite, our easy-to-read grid format, and our monthly updated logs, and interesting ads and information. So for your free sample to Channel Guide or Galaxy One, call now. Operators are standing by. 1-800-654-3006. That's Channel Guide, a free sample copy, by calling 1-800-654-3006.
Quality, performance, and strength, and all at a highly competitive price. That's the all-new Trans 10 Mesh by Qualtronics. Engineered for maximum durability and reflective surface, the Trans 10 is also extremely easy to look at. It has a baked acrylic, thermal-set black finish that gives it that low-luster appeal. Aesthetically speaking, the Trans 10 is not just another beautiful dish. It's got plenty of other qualities to back it up. The extra-strength hub is parabolically formed to maximize signal strength. Like the keystone of a great building, the hub is engineered of 3/16-inch prime steel and measures a solid 14.5 inches in diameter. The ribs are made of superior strength tubular 16-gauge steel encased in polytrans vinyl, especially formulated for the satellite industry. The end result, solid strength, at the same time minimizing the size of the ribbing. This avoids the bulky appearance of so many mesh antennas. The polytrans vinyl ribs of the Trans 10, in another innovative feature, have full half-inch unobstructed mesh retaining channels. The mesh panels slide smoothly into place, simply and surely, making for fast assembly time and snug positioning. Another bonus is better retention of panels in high wind areas and maximum reflector signal with no gaps in that reflective area. It's a distinct advantage over other mesh designs. High gain means better performance. The Trans 10 has an outer rim of rigid extruded aluminum anchored securely to the ribs and center hub to form a solid framework for the panels. The mesh panels are of expanded flattened aluminum with a 1.040 thickness and 0.045 strand width. The mesh and all exposed frame parts have a baked acrylic thermoset finish. All antenna hardware is plated for weather protection. The Trans 10, with its 10-foot diameter, is designed for maximum gain, a focal length of 44 1/4 inches, and an FD ratio of 0.375. The Trans 10 is UPS shippable anywhere in the United States with a weight of 145 pounds without mount. It means easy handling. Without a doubt, the Trans 10 by Qualtronics is the front runner in the industry, the ultimate mesh antenna design because of quality, performance, and eye appeal.
Are you confused about satellite programming guides? Are you tired of monthly inaccurate guides that are big and bulky and about as much fun to use as a city phone book? How about tabloids with hard-to-read print, incomplete movie listings that are about as easy to use as a roadmap? or newspaper guides with confusing grids that fall apart in your hands. There is an alternative. OnSet, the easy-to-read, easy-to-use weekly programming guide with more movies and sports. Best of all, OnSet is only $39. That's right, 52 issues for only $39. But don't take our word for it. We'll send you a free copy of OnSet, and you can judge for yourself. And if you're a dealer, ask about our dealer program. Make your customers happy and make money. Call OnSet now. Toll free, 1-800-438-2020. Or write OnSet, Box 2347, Shelby, North Carolina, 28150. OnSet, you've seen the rest, now try the best.
Hello, I'm Pat Olson, and this is Industry News with the cooperation of the news staff at Satellite TV Magazine. The women in satellite communications will hold two meetings during the upcoming Space STTI show at the Las Vegas MGM Grand Hotel on March 31st, April 1st, and 2nd. A meeting of the interim board is set for 3 p.m. March 31st in the Metro One room of the MGM Grand, while a meeting open to the general public is set for 3 p.m. April 1st in the Metro V room. Installation of a new board of directors will take place during the April 1st meeting. Calltronics Incorporated of Richland Center, Wisconsin will be hosting a workshop meeting for all of its Trans 10 antenna distributors just prior to the opening of the Las Vegas show. The meeting is set for the afternoon of Saturday, March 30th at the MGM Grand. The financially troubled United Satellite Communications Incorporated reportedly has entered into talks with Viacom International, a 50% owner of Showtime, the movie channel. A spokesman for Viacom said that a possible involvement with the struggling direct broadcast service was not a high priority among the company's other ventures, such as pay-per-view. The Georgia Electrical membership is joining a growing list of rural electric cooperatives that have gotten into the home satellite business. The move by the utility to sell systems on a commercial basis has drawn strong opposition from the Georgia Satellite TV Dealers Association, which claims a membership of more than 250 people. The state currently has a law on its books which prohibits EMC from entering the cable television business, and the Dealers Association believes the move by the utility to enter the commercial TVRO marketplace should also be covered by that law. The television auction has purchased 7 hours a week on the satellite program network to telecast the auction show, which is taped at a San Jose flea market. The three-year-old show has been primarily directed to the cable market, but has been drawing viewers with home satellite systems and has grossed $1 million in telephone sales. The company says it expects to gross $65 million by the end of this year. The fast-paced show draws more than 1,800 calls an hour. Some cable companies have said they will block out the auction program if they don't receive a percentage of the gross profit from it. That's industry news for now. I'm Pat Olson.
The satellite industry has come a long way in the past 4 years. In 1979, we had the first trade show, if you will, in Oklahoma. A handful of people gathered with some very crude and often basement-built equipment. Probably less than 1,000 systems were sold in 79 and 80. Where is it going to go in 84? Taylor, you've been involved in the industry almost since its inception. Where do you think it's going to go?
Well, I kind of object to the characterization of it being built in basements. I built my satellite system in my garage. That's literally where it started. And I think in 1979, we looked at the people we had at the show in Oklahoma City in 1979, which was the first one. It was mainly hobbyists. There were a few businessmen and quite a few that were building their own equipment, hams, other type of hobbyists, people bailing out from the Citizens Band radio business. We see quite a different character in it now. If you look at our panel, and as I talk to people that are in the audience today that were at our dinner last night, we see mainly responsible business people now. Good engineers, a few of the hobbyists left, but not very many. It's turned into a real consumer business, one where the businessmen and the engineers are looking at something very different from the hobby aspects of it. I think we've seen the equipment grow in sophistication and come down in cost an immense amount. It was just unpredictable a few years ago that things would cost this low and work this well. The changes in the equipment have been spectacular. I think that there's some fundamental things happen that were unpredictable that have made what we have now, DBS at C-band, really happen. And that they're fundamental things in solid-state physics that have made it possible to get really low noise amplifiers. And we'll talk more about it in the panel, but I think this has driven the system. It's changed the antennas, it's changed the receivers, and it's certainly changed the way that all of us look at C-band versus K-band and the coming DBS system.
When we talk about DBS, of course, we're referring to the generic DBS that's 12 gigahertz, I assume.
Well, the direct broadcast satellite idea has been around for very nearly 20 years, and it's always been, at least in the international arena where we make treaties regarding the use of frequencies, it's been a 12 gigahertz game. That's changed in many people's regard now. It was thought the technology would drive us to 12 gigahertz. It's very clear that direct broadcast can now be done at any frequency we want, and in fact we have more than 100 channels of direct broadcast now if you accept a little larger dish size than the DBS people would have. The whole idea of DBS and the developments that I've been involved in for since the early 70s is that you can have a system that will have a 1 or 2 foot dish and a few dollars worth of electronics and have very good television from it. It's always been limited in the number of channels that were going to be available. Nobody foresaw this thing where we would have the ability to receive at this frequency range and receive literally hundreds of channels. That was never thought of, and that's a surprise to the planners as well as to those of us who are engineers.
I think it was Ted Turner who said in Orlando at the space show that, hey guys, DBS is here, alive and well. And he was, of course, referring to the existing 4 gigahertz service. As the editor of a magazine, I receive a lot of mail from all kinds of people who don't own systems and are interested in buying them, people who have systems from dealers, distributors, manufacturers. One of the biggest problems that seems to concern these people today is the hoopla that has surrounded the proposed 2-degree spacing plans. My position is that the 2-degree spacing has probably been overemphasized and it's not as serious a problem as was first anticipated. I think with the developments of electronics, antenna technology, and certainly the formatting of the satellites themselves, cross-polarity between adjacent satellites, that it will not be as big as a problem as perhaps we first anticipated. Mike, how are electronics going to affect 2-degree spacing and performance of systems?
Well, early on, the EIA proposed a standard of some number of dB carrier to noise or carrier interference ratios, and that was based on a technology that's quite old. The newer technologies embodied in the KLMs, the Gillespies, the Earth stations type receivers, are such that they are less prone to adjacent interference. They have a higher capture ratio, if you will. So a prior number that was used by the EIA of 20 years ago before satellites were really in orbit are found now to be still valid as far as the absolute value is concerned, but as an operational standpoint, the number is dropped to the 12 to 13 dB range, which means that it will allow a lot smaller dish to operate. The current indications are that an 8-foot antenna is right on the line, and anything larger than that is going to survive the tighter spacing very quickly. Right now, that spacing is available for test if you'd like. If you have the fortune or misfortune of being either a user or a manufacturer on the East Coast, you have essentially 2-degree spacing between Galaxy 1 and SATCOM 3 right now. On the West Coast, if you wanted to try to play around and see if your system will work, is G2 and SATCOM F2R on 1.7 degree spacing effective. The best place to be if you're going to want to run real small dishes is in Denver. There, because of the geometry, none of the satellites, even when closer spaced, are ever going to get down to less than about 2.5 degrees. that right there mitigates the situation considerably. The other concept is that people often forget that there are actually two different band plans, if you will, currently available on the satellites, the so-called Westar series and the SATCOM series, RC AmeriCom. These have what is called orthogonal polarizations, which means that vertical of one transponder is horizontal of the other. That gives you an effective isolation, if it's done right, of about 25 dB, which is more than enough to survive. So effectively, if you're looking at SATCOM 3, and Galaxy 1 will not cause a problem because it is on orthogonal polarizations. That is a very big factor in this. And the FCC is considering and being petitioned by many of the big companies to rethink their 2-degree spacing entirely, but notwithstanding any changes there, they're looking into having a little tighter control of which satellites go where. And they're trying to drop in, if you will, a opposite satellite in between two common satellites. That way, effectively, you're back to 4-degree spacing, even if they are 2 degrees apart. But because of the opposite polarization, it gives you the isolation. Unfortunately, the band plant, or the satellite plant, is already in place, and a lot of that can't be changed. They're there, and it would take quite a bit of rearranging of satellites. You just don't pick them up like blocks of wood and move them around. Hopefully, they're going to allow a longer, as the satellites die off and are replaced, they'll be able to have an effect that will indicate that in that slot a certain kind of satellite must go for proper operation. From my standpoint, from a commercial standpoint, the even more serious problem, notwithstanding the TVRO person or user, is the uplink. Right now we are on the tighter spacing between Telstar 301 and Westar 4, as an example. We are experiencing adjacent satellite interference, that uplink interference. That means that an uplinker going into Telstar 301 is also illuminating and powering into Westar 4. And they're running 7 and 9 meter dishes, but they're also running very high powers. So this kind of a problem is going to get worse, and that's what I think is going to have the most impact on the industry from the commercial standpoint, and will probably move the FCC to do something to mitigate that particular situation. We're seeing quite a bit of complaints. An example is they were testing two new satellites down on the lower end of the arc, and they were having a very difficult time, both of the two opposite companies trying to talk to both their satellites that kept illuminating the other satellite, and they were finally had to come to some agreement and transmit at one time for one satellite and transmit to another one for testing purposes, because they were parked very, very close together at that point. So between the opposite polarization plant and the FCC being pressured quite heavily by some rather large corporations like Hughes Communications and RCA, they'll probably have some effect and will affect it.
Okay, the bottom line is, what does the dealer tell his customer? My mother and father would like to buy a system. Obviously, they don't want a system any larger than they require. They live in a suburban neighborhood. There will be certain problems associated with putting a dish in the backyard. What do I tell them, Mike? They've heard of 2-degree spacing. They're a little concerned that they may run into a problem a few years down the road. So what do I tell them when they come to me and say, hey, Chris, what should we buy? Should we buy an 8-foot antenna, a 10-foot, a 12-foot?
Well, in my opinion, at that point, you are betting. You're betting that if you put in an 8-foot dish, that it will succeed. I personally have tested some dishes, that 8-foot dishes that will operate quite nicely in 2-degree spacing. I've also tested some 8-foot dishes that do not. So I think the first thing is that some of the manufacturers of the smaller apertures, it's incumbent on them to prove to the world their dish operates in this tighter spacing. Certainly someone who wants to sell a 12-foot dish is almost guaranteed, unless it's a terrible 12-foot dish, that it's going to operate fine. So I think that the bottom line comes to that point of the proper selection of a receiver, and if you put in an 8-foot dish, then you're betting that either the FCC changes its plans or orthogonal satellites go in, and if all goes well, your 8-foot dish was a good one to begin with, and it'll pass just fine. Keep in mind, this is not going to happen tomorrow. They are talking 10-year.
The most resistant to interference of any of them. We're very lucky in that regard for our TVRO work. It's the other users, data users, business users, and so on, that are really concerned over this, and that's going to be the driver that will fend off some of the really tight spacing. As Mike was pointing out, we're already in trouble with the uplinks, which is of no concern to sports fans and so on. There are some other things coming along, though, in the development of detectors, high capture ratio detectors, that are going to change this radically. I have a system running now that will survive in 1.5 degree spacing on a 5-foot dish. It doesn't care about signals that are of equal strength in the passband. And it's this sort of thing that will change our regard for 2-degree spacing. So my answer to Mike's question in view of electronic developments is, don't worry about it.
When can we expect to see?
This year.
That should make all the small dish people very, very happy, I'm sure. Peter, KLM, as a corporate decision, how does KLM view 2-degree spacing? You're arguably either number one or number two in volume in receivers in the country. I'm not sure where right now. Obviously, you must be looking at this, and at some point in time, you must have been concerned and decided how receivers should be designed. I'm sure that with David Barker, he's aware of the capture ratio of demodulators. You also manufacture antennas. You had to make a decision on the size and type of antennas you built. How is KLM facing up to the 2-degree problem?
Well, from the technical standpoint, Chris, we believe that we're in good shape relative to 2-degree spacing. From the market standpoint, I think that if, in fact, 2-degree spacing becomes a reality, it is only going to enhance the business and the volume for the industry. You know, commenting about or following up on what Taylor had to say, I think that 1984 is going to be just an unbelievably spectacular year volume-wise. And in absolute numbers, I think that we are headed towards 600,000 units this year, which translates to well over $1 billion. I think that the garage or the basement business of 1979 and 1980 is in 1984 well over $1 billion, perhaps $1.4 billion. And that on a compounded growth rate is just an incredible number. I don't think scare, as it originally was, of 2-degree spacing is going to impact that negatively, and in fact may become a very positive impact. Already there are some 120 channels available. If 2-degree spacing becomes a reality, it's plausible that there will be 220 channels available. Selection of programming becomes virtually unlimited, makes the product more desirable. The other thing that I think is going to continue to accelerate or add high-octane fuel to 1984 is, aside from the small dishes, is the fact that cost engineering and cost technology continues to be a factor. And as the price of the systems, although I think the major decrease has occurred, as the price of the systems continues to come down, the product becomes affordable by more and more people. And I think all of that translates to an enormous year for 1984. Whether we can handle it remains to be seen.
I think that's a very valid point.
I have a comment. Mike Taylor and Peter have alluded to this, the concept that the statement that it is true that our industry has matured and grown extremely sophisticated and large and run by true businessmen. I know Taylor's background quite heavily, and I think the thing I have to comment on is I want to encourage that the backyard engineer, the backyard hobbyist, the guy who feels he's not going to be able to contribute anymore, that's not true. What has changed is that that person is not going to bring the product to the market. He will develop this new black box that does wonderful and great things. And he will find that there are now many, many, many companies that will snap up his product and sells it to Peter, and Peter markets it for him. but you're not going to find this lone entrepreneur showing up anymore at one of the shows with his little metal box and sitting there trying to sell a 10 of them that he brought, because that's all he could build the night before.
Yeah, I agree. I can recall many shows ago when virtually working all night the night before the show, finishing at 5 o'clock in the morning, wiring something together on a printed circuit board, catching the plane at 7 and flying into Omaha or Anaheim or wherever it was, and saying, here's our prototype, and crowds of people around, and everybody was excited and enthusiastic. And that's really what got this industry started.
Yes, absolutely.
There's no doubt about that. But now it is time. We do need the professional marketers, businessmen, financiers, like Peter, to take over and make the whole thing really gel and go together. Jacob, LNAs are a critical part in this whole system, and frankly, it's the LNA technology that has made home TVROs work. We were commenting last night at dinner that trying to find out who paid the most for their first LNA, and my friend Mike once again beat us all and paid $2,800 for an LNA. So any of the dealers who call you and complain that the price on your LNAs are too high, come go see Mike. I paid $1,600 for an LNA. I can buy one.
$2,800, didn't you?
Yeah, $2,800. I can buy one today for less than $300. It's come a long way.
Obviously.
Where are we going to go from here?
Well, the LNA market has gone a long way. It was technology driven, and I believe it's bound to take a few side routes as far as branching into a little bit more technology, a little bit more change into LMBs, and probably a lowering of the volume in LNCs.
That's a very good point. Why didn't LNCs catch on like perhaps most of us thought it would? What happened there?
I believe that the LNC idea had some drawbacks in marketing. A dealer and a distributor find a lot more freedom in marketing an amplifier with his choice of receiver and down converter than tying himself up with an amplifier, down converter, and one enclosure, and immediately having to buy a specific receiver. People are able to keep, obviously, LNAs on the shelf, while they would not be able to keep LNCs on the shelf. The degree of marketability is significantly higher, and I believe that's the driving factor. There is some other reasons, which are side reasons, that LNC are not acceptable as well as LNAs, and that regards to the, decrease in MTBF, or the failure rate of this critical box sitting at the focus of the antenna and exposed to weather. The down converter is usually more protected. It causes a complete system shutdown and difficult to replace an LNC once it fails with another LNC. It requires some adjustments in the receiver, while, as we know, an LNA is easily replaceable.
Are we facing the similar problems with an LMB, which for our audience is a low noise block down converter, which allows you simultaneous reception of the 12 channels per polarity? Aren't we facing the same problem trying to market the LMB?
I believe that the LMB has more more appeal because it's more versatile. It allows wiring of extra receivers at a lower cost. It requires, or say it differently, does not require an extra cable of tuning voltage. It's indeed a more complex assembly than an LNA by itself, and obviously will have higher failure rate, or I wouldn't use higher failure, I use the term MTB, a minimum time between failures. It is more superior, I think, both from a marketeer's position to the LNC. I do not foresee the LNB market to be close in size to the remaining LNA market. The LNA by itself will remain as the winning element or the most common element, with the LNB taking a portion of the LNC market and probably taking and converting a portion of the LNAs into LNBs. I see the LNC market slowly reduced in size with time on the account, of course, of the LNB.
In the conventional LNA design, they put a little device in the front end called an isolator. There are several LNA manufacturers that are now delivering lower cost, lower noise amplifiers that do not have the isolator in the front end. I've had a lot of dealers call me up and say, can we expect any problems? What are the advantages, disadvantages of having the isolator versus not having the isolator? Does CalAmp build an amplifier without the isolator in the front end?
Indeed we do, and that's what I referred in new technologies. A non-isolated amplifier would not be regarded as purely new technology, probably new circuitry. You brought it up, and it's a very good subject to cover. We indeed manufacture an amplifier without an isolator. The key in making such a product is achieving what we call an unconditionally stable circuit regarding mainly the first gallium arsenide FET. Once that's achieved, and if it's achieved at a low labor rate without too much effort, it becomes feasible to manufacture, and obviously the manufacturer ends up saving one of the probably the most expensive component in the LNA, which is the isolator itself. There is some disagreements between manufacturers that make the non-isolated amplifier. In addition to us, there is at least I believe two more as to what is the right method to test noise figure on these amplifiers. We came up with a method that I believe is conservative. As far as we know, it will be difficult to achieve through this method amplifiers that will be 80, 70 degrees flat in noise figure across the band. We find more reasonable to assume that most non-isolated amplifiers will operate with extreme noise figure variation over the band. That means they might be 70 degrees at one end while 110 degrees at the other end of the frequency band. That is the method that we employ in testing. These are the results, and obviously a product that I mentioned a moment ago would be sold as a 110 degrees, despite the fact that the majority of the frequency band would be nicely below 100 degrees. Remains to be settled. The results from the field are very positive. There is a very good acceptance, except of the cases that, of course, you have an unstable amplifier, which could happen. In that case, you have an invalid product. When the product operates like it should, the end user has excellent results. Indeed, the 70, 80 degrees noise temperature on some portions of the band give positive results, especially when you sell it as a 120. Most end users love it.
The key to that, though, I think, is getting it unconditionally stable in all regimes of operation. Up until now, or maybe until the technology you've introduced, the problem has been, there have been other companies tried to do that, and spent, I can attest to personally, at least $500,000 trying to build an LNA that was unconditionally stable in all regimes. I was not able to. So the key is going to be the FET, getting the FET and the Zines under control so that the change of a dish, if it'll work on on XYZ dish, but it won't work on so-and-so's dish. And I have a personal bug about this, and that is I think LNAs that do not have isolators ought to be marked so. And the reason for that is that at least it'll let you know that what you're dealing with. A lot of the LNAs that I have seen that didn't have isolators in them look like a common isolator. And that's good. I mean, I'm sure from the marketer's standpoint, there's a reason for that.
I understand. There is a necessity to mark those products separately. We do mark them. We call the non-isolated line the basic. For the matter of fact, we have protected the circuitry that we have developed, and we have a patent pending on the circuitry that we developed to stabilize, if I might say, the first FET. And the item that I feel still needs to be resolved is the method of testing, which might be resolved in conjunction with other manufacturers. I think it was brought up at a first meeting of a manufacturers association, which is trying to be set up these days. And it will be a subject that will be covered. But in principle, we mark ours, and we call them the basics. We have protected, in a way, our circuitry, and we believe that that our circuit, and I believe other people's circuit too, is designed to take every impedance, if I might say, or in simple terms, every antenna.
I think, again, the question boils down to, and I'd ask both Jacob and Mike, is should I have any concern putting a non-isolator type LNA in my mother and father's system in their backyard? Should they have any reason for concern, Jacob? Right now.
No, I don't see any problem. We have had difficulties to develop the product. We've gone through that period to create this unconditionally stable circuit. There should not be any operational penalties, if I might use that term, for using a non-isolated versus an isolated. It's perfectly all right for you to put it in your grandma's system. Yes.
Chris, TDF has entered the LNA manufacturing field.
High-Tech Amplifier, actually. A sister company. Yeah.
Okay. High-Tech, that's a non-isolator LNA.
That's correct.
It's a very small unit, very compact, very light. High-Tech has obviously made a commitment to feel that their LNAs are stable, that the isolator is not required. How is High-Tech doing?
Fine. I wish I could speak more knowledgeably on it. I'm not directly involved with that end of it. I do know I'm wondering, Jacob mentioned kind of establishing standards for testing. Is that what you meant, or did you mean for marking the LNA or for specifying its noise temperature? I know we've examined some LNAs where, like he says, they tend to be less linear in their output across the band than non-isolated LNA. And we have seen some that vary tremendously across the band, and the manufacturer will choose three low points on the band and state that as the noise temperature of the device, which, if you put it on the test equipment, that is indeed true at those frequencies, but it'll have peaks in the 140-150 degree range. That's, I think, where the problem is, you know.
We hope you enjoyed the show today. Remember, we'll be here next week, same time, same place.